This is a recording for the arrival of a professor who has become a worldwide phenomenon on economics because of the data that is put together and the assertions that this data tells us. Is this the future that we are seeing? Surely there are no real answers in this book, just challenges that are presented and different various ways in which these challenges can be confronted. Professor Thomas Piketty, good afternoon and welcome.
Thank you.
Are you a Marxist?
No, you know, I belong to a generation. I turned 18 in 1989 with the fall of the Berlin Wall. So, you know, I was too young to be tempted by, Soviet-type communism. So, you know, I some people still live in the Cold War, but this is their problem, not mine. You know, I live in the 21st century, and I believe in market forces. I believe in private property, but I think we need strong democratic institutions in order to control these powerful forces and to put market forces into the common interest. And otherwise, you know, we can get to a level of concentration of power and wealth that is just not compatible with sustainable development.
R is greater than G, rate of return being greater than growth. I mean, the relationship between the two, return and growth. Can you explain that phenomenon that centers around this book?
Well, you know, this book first tries to put together the historical experience from over 20 countries across three centuries. So, of course, you cannot explain everything in the history of inequality just with one mechanism. There are many powerful forces, unequal access to education, unequal labor market, which play an important role. Now, on the financial side, it is true that the tendency of the rate of return to capital, especially for large wealth portfolio, to exceed the economy's growth rate in the long run can be one of the powerful forces pushing toward a large concentration of wealth. So to be very concrete, if you take data on world billionaires published by magazine like Forbes or others, and you take the past 30 years, you see that very top wealth holders have been rising at 6, 7, 8% per year. Whereas the size of the world economy and average wealth or average income in the world has been rising at 1, 2, 3% per year. Now, you cannot have the top rising 2, 3 times faster than the average forever. You know, I think everybody can understand this. You know, even if you want to have entrepreneur, you are ready to accept some level of inequality. In the long run, it's okay if you have rich people, poor people, but you want everybody to rise more or less at the same speed. Mm-hmm. If the top is rising 3 times faster than the average, at some point, this means that, you know, 100% of the wealth and power will be concentrated at the top. So I'm not saying this will go so far. This will probably stop below that, but we don't know exactly where it will stop. So I think that's why it's important to have more transparency about wealth and income, and that's something that's lacking in many countries, particularly in South Africa, where we don't have good instruments to measure the concentration of wealth and how it has changed since the end of apartheid. And I think better access to estate tax data and also the creation of an annual wealth tax with very low tax rate to begin with will be a way to produce that kind of information and democratic transparency on which a democratic debate can then start, and then we can decide to adjust our policies, our tax rate, or other policies like BE policies, so that we know where we are going. But right now, in South Africa, but also in other countries, you know, we don't know very well who owns what in South Africa and how this has changed. And this lack of transparency, to me, is a big danger for democracy and sustainable development.
Reading this book and looking at some of the commentary and the interviews you've had before, I believe selfishly that this book is meant for South Africa. And in one of your interviews, you actually talk about the two things that opposition parties, be they small, are stressing: redistribution of land and of wealth as well. It would be receptive in this country for sure, but how far are we in your assessment of the data? Because you have said you're disappointed that after 20 years of liberation in this country, we are nowhere near where we should be. Is there a way to look at this trajectory as, you know, the slow pace is crippling us, but how far do you think we can stretch with this current status quo?
Well, South Africa has been able to achieve a peaceful democratic transition toward equal formal rights, which is already a lot as compared to the previous legal regime where, you know, the vast majority of the population did not have the same formal rights.
Yes.
Now, equality in formal rights is not enough. The next stage is equality in real rights. So this includes rights to education, right to work for a decent wage, and I think a national minimum wage is absolutely critical. Right to property and right to democracy and balanced sharing of economic power. Land reform never really happened in South Africa. If you
yes.
compare to other experience in Europe or in Asia, where you have large land reform after World War II in Japan, in Korea, in Taiwan, and many people believe that this was part of the successful development experience in the post-war period, because you start from a level playing field where you don't have excessive concentration of assets, and I think this would be necessary in South Africa. Progressive tax on net individual wealth is also a way, together with straight land reform and land redistribution, is a way to limit the concentration of wealth and to allow low wealth groups to enter the distribution. So the objective is certainly not to discourage wealth accumulation,
yes.
but to encourage accumulation, but at the same time to encourage mobility, wealth mobility and newcomers into the distribution of wealth, which is really lacking in South Africa.
Final question, because we have time precious. South Africa has an almost flawless social system, the social welfare system of grants, but we have weaknesses in education. And we're not talking about making people rich. We're making people aware that there is wealth that can be created, especially at the bottom part of the economy. We are very, very far from that. But you are stressing education as one of those vehicles or levers that can be pulled to get people to realize their opportunities when they're there.
Right. I think the public resources that are allocated to basic primary school and junior high school for the most disadvantaged group in this country, well, I think these public resources are probably not enough. And it's very difficult to overcome this long legacy of inequality without sort of more voluntary action in this area. And we are talking a lot about the high unemployment in this country, but I think part of it could be overcome by more public investment in public infrastructure, transportation, and also the public school system. And in the future, this is really the key for sustainable growth and equitable growth in this country.
Pardon me. In closing, when are you back in South Africa to have more of a chat with us?
Well, very soon. I very much hope to develop more collaboration with South Africa, with France, and other research centers in Europe. And I very much hope next time I will have more time to travel across your fascinating country.
Professor Thomas Piketty, thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.